And I want to convince you that A, virtual reality is coming like a freight train, and B, with your leadership and collaboration, we can leverage the things about virtual reality that can make the world a better place. So, structure of today, all of you will leave knowing how the technology of VR works. I'm then going to talk about the catch-22 of virtual reality, which is that if I give you a perceptual immersive experience, the brain will treat it as if it were real. However, anything's possible in VR. I can break physics. I can change your identity in a mirror. I can clone you. And so this really great opportunity where the brain treats it as real, but there's no rules, is something we can use to applications to make people better. So show of hands, how many of you guys have worn a helmet and walked around in VR before? Wow, fantastic, barely any of you. Okay, how many of you guys have played Pac-Man? Okay, VR is really just fancy Pac-Man. All virtual reality is three things: tracking your physical movements as you walk around the room. In Pac-Man, we did that with a joystick that tracks your wrist movement. Rendering a scene that is redrawing content based on that movement. So in Pac-Man, you move your head to the left, you move your hand to the left, and it draws that biter one scene over. And then sending new perceptual information to the eyes and the ears, the skin, and then sometimes the nose. In Pac-Man, they drew a new scene on a screen and they played sounds off a speaker. So in my lab, we've got fancy camera equipment that can sense your movements as you're walking around. So as you step, we know within 1/10 of 1 millimeter where you've walked. We know this 200 frames a second. We know if you've smiled. We know how you've moved your legs. This is called tracking, sensing your movements. We then redraw the scene based on those movements. So if I walk a meter forward, you guys get a little closer. If I turn my head this way, I get to see you guys. So I want to give you a demonstration of this, and this is what it looks like. What do you think this guy is doing? Feel free to yell out. He's walking the plank, okay? So what's happening here is he put on the helmet, and he puts on this, he gets to see the room. We've built the 3D model of the room so that 99% of people think they're seeing see-through video. It's actually a 3D model that we're redrawing as he moves. So he just thinks he's seeing stereoscopic video of the room. We then dropped a 10-meter chasm, and he looks over there, and we put a very rickety plank, and we ask him to walk across, okay? For almost 20 years, I've been running at least 1,000 people through demonstrations like this. And the first time this happened to me back in 1999, I was at a conference with lawyers and judges, and somebody fell off the pit, and what he did in order to save his life, he dove at a 45-degree angle to try to catch the virtual lip. Okay? Luckily, I was there, and I caught him, and he didn't get hurt. That was the first time that happened to me. This now happens to me 2 or 3 times a week. The technology is so real, the brain treats this virtual experience as real. It's very, very powerful, very, very powerful. And if you come to Stanford, we do public tours every Friday. We really view part of our job as outreach, so when you come back, we'll give you a tour. We do have the best immersive virtual reality lab in the world. I can say this without bragging because I just let the really brilliant Stanford engineer undergraduates do all the work for me on the engineering side. So most of my work is actually done by Stanford undergraduates, but NASA comes to my lab, the military comes to my lab, heads of states come to my lab, the government comes to figure out what to do. Mark Zuckerberg spent 3 hours with me in March, and then 2 weeks later spent $2.3 billion to buy the company that makes this. This is called the Oculus Rift, and I sadly took down that helmet you see in that picture about 4 days ago. We took down that $40,000 helmet and replaced it with this, which cost $200. So we are a destination where people who want to understand what the technology is and how it works. But now that I've bragged about my lab, let me tell you that my lab is becoming completely and utterly obsolete. I meet with leaders from these companies fairly often, as well as many others, and all of them are engaging in an arms race to be the first one to bring this technology to your living room. So if I had to predict, I don't think you're going to see it this holiday season, but I think shortly thereafter you will be buying virtual reality for your kids, your grandkids, your significant others very soon. So hopefully you now have a sense of how the technology works. What I'm going to do now is give you about 5 or 6 examples about how we're leveraging this paradox that it feels real, but we get to make the rules to change people's behavior to make them better. And in general, the big theme is a very intense virtual experience has profound effects and transfers out to the real world. The first study I want to talk about was actually the honors thesis of a woman named Shawnee Bowman. She wanted to look at the opposite of the video game violence research. So for decades, scholars have been asking the question, when you play violent video games for 10 hours a day, are you more aggressive in the physical world? And their research shows basically an unequivocal yes to this question. We want to do the opposite. What if you give someone an incredible, immersive experience that's extremely arousing and intense, and you save a child's life, you do something good, will this transfer to the real world? So let me show you what this looks like.
There has been an earthquake warning, and the city has been evacuated. A child has been unaccounted for, and the parents have informed authorities that their child is diabetic and will go into shock without insulin. You have a vial of insulin in your pocket. Your task is to fly through the city to find the child and deliver the insulin, saving the child's life. As soon as you see the child, call out. You must indicate to the experimenter that you found the child, so please clearly announce that you see the child when the child comes into view. You may now begin your search. Lift your arms above your head to take off from the ground.
So people sweat when this happens. Very intense. Steve Robinson from NASA, who's been millions and billions of miles in space, says this is the closest he's ever been to spacewalking. Shaking to give him vibrations.
Thankfully, you've reached the child before diabetic shock set in. You hand the syringe to the child who injects the insulin. You have now completed your task and saved the child's life.
Okay, so he saved the child's life in VR, and then we always want to test real behavior. We never do questionnaires. We do this then. Sean, this is Shawnee, the scholar who did this work.
Did you have any trouble with dizziness or anything? Okay.
So we videotape that interaction, and we see if you help, how quickly you help, and how thoroughly you help. If you flew like Superman and saved that child's life, you're more likely to help someone who has a physical accident later on compared to a variety of control conditions. The next line of work we do is trying to get people to show more empathy to the environment. So it turns out the relationship between our behavior and the impact on the environment is very abstract. 97% of scientists believe in climate change, but only half of the population does. And how can we get this more visceral? So this is an experiment based on an op-ed by a woman named Leslie Kaufman that ran in the New York Times in 2009. If you use that beautiful, soft, fluffy toilet paper that we all love, over the course of your lifetime, you're going up to Muir Woods in Northern California, and you're sawing down two virgin trees. Is basically the equivalent if you're using that toilet paper that comes from non-recycled paper. That doesn't change anything. In the Bay Area, Costco does not carry non-recycled toilet paper, recycled toilet paper. Safeway only carries one brand. We're using a lot of paper for a non-essential task. So in our study, we gave everybody those stats. One group of subjects then read what it would be like to cut down a tree. A second group saw a video shot from the first person of a lumberjack cutting down a tree. The third group did what you see in this picture. She had a haptic device that shakes her hands, and we forced her to cut down two trees. And when the trees fell, it thundered the floor and bounced her legs up. We found ways to track their paper use. When you get this simulation, use 20% less paper later on compared to the other conditions. So a virtual experience, we would never ask you to go out and cut down real trees to learn this lesson that you should buy recycled toilet paper. In VR, it's free and easy to do. We've done work where you walk up to yourself, see yourself in a virtual mirror, hit a button, and then you see yourself how you're going to look when you're 65 years old. This is based on a philosopher named Parfit. Parfit says that it's easy for humans to imagine pleasure now, but hard to imagine pain later. So we use this, we worked with Bank of America as a way to build a tool to get people to connect with their future self so that they can actually find a way to save money now as opposed to spend frivolously. And this has caused more people to put money in a savings account than just about any other control condition. The game today is going to be, for better or worse, some tiny part of my research may affect some of the outcomes. So Coach Shaw is allowing us to have 5 minutes of practice time a week to film in virtual reality a couple of plays that the other defenses are probably going to run. Then Kevin Hogan, the backup quarterbacks and the running backs, train in VR to be able to detect plays, pick up blitzes, and to think about what they should be doing differently on the line of scrimmage. Classrooms, I work with Tina Seelig. We've got a class on using VR to teach creativity. I'm actually teaching Carol Dweck's growth mindset in one of the simulations that we're doing. We think a lot about the next step of the MOOC is actually being there. So we've modeled a coral reef off the coast of Ischia, an island off Italy, a Fiumicelli, a Stanford professor, to bring as a lab students into the ocean so they can learn about the future of global warming. So I was recently appointed the faculty director of the Digital Learning Forum at Stanford, and it's my job to make these MOOCs leverage the technology that our president was just talking about. A long line of research about diversity training. Imagine walking up to a mirror and seeing yourself go with your skin changeable color, or you'll go to a different gender, or you'll age, or you'll become handicapped. And in a decade of research, we've demonstrated that by having somebody walk a mile in someone else's shoes, you can reduce prejudice. So I want to conclude by saying thank you so much for allowing me to talk to you. Come out and do virtual reality. Yep.